Are
Okay,
we
and we're
live?
live. We're really, really live this time. Cool. So,
Keeps.net.
a
Okay.
little bit of a rocky start, and I apologize. Most of it was because I needed coffee, and a little bit of
Most
it was because of Google.
of it was my fault.
Speaking of coffee, though, I really think that you guys, if you like coffee, should watch Matt Stauffer's 5-Minute Geek Show. Because he pretty much explained exactly the way I make my coffee. And so you too can be late for things.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that more people are getting into that. Just little short videos. It's cool. We haven't done that in the past. Well, what's fun too is like it's easy now. Like 5 or 10 years ago, this was a lot harder. Or at least it was harder for us. Even things like creating screencasts like I do. I got started doing this like 7 or 8 years ago. Back then, it was so hard because you'd record a screencast, and if you uploaded it to YouTube, it was so compressed that you couldn't see anything. So it was like 320 back then. So like making a good screencast was incredibly difficult back then. But now it's so much easier. So it's cool that lots of people are doing this stuff.
Yeah, I really enjoy it, and I don't know, full-time job and the kids and everything. It's kind of hard to fit in big hour-long chunks to the little 5 minutes in the morning, usually while I'm making coffee. Works pretty well. Okay, so need to tweet the link for this, but hold on. So you mentioned screencasts, and obviously, or I think obviously. I know you, and most people know you from Laracasts, but you've been doing this considerably longer.
Real quick, people are saying the site isn't live. 45 seconds of the first try.
Oh.
Sorry to interrupt.
That's okay. That's unfortunate. 2 seconds. Okay. While I'm doing this, I know you from Laracasts. I know a lot of people know you from Laracasts, but you've been doing this for a lot longer. So, how did you get your start doing screencasts?
It's not like I set out to do this. It's one of those things that we fall into. It's not like when I was a boy, I had a dream that I would make PHP screencasts. Basically, how it turned out is I was getting into this stuff about 10 years ago, and it's really hard. Like, I think all of us can agree, like, it's ridiculously hard. So, and especially like the way I got into it was completely the wrong way. I got into it by learning ASP before I had even learned things like HTML. So like I did the wrong approach completely. So it was so incredibly overwhelming that I was learning about all of these like server controls and stuff with ASP, but I didn't even understand what a div was. Like I literally could not figure out why would you have a div. And we forget like so many of us have been doing it for a long time, but you forget that was hard to figure out. So it's like you have HTML and you wrap it in a div. And nothing changes. So it's like, okay, well, why did I do this? And then like somebody told me, oh, think of it as a bucket, and then if you need to move the bucket around, you can do it. And then suddenly it made sense. So I was trying to figure out all this stuff, and I started creating videos specifically for me. It was like, okay, I think I understand this close enough, so I'm going to record a video just in case I forget it, I can return to it. I did that a lot, and it was almost like my way of taking notes. Just do a quick video, and also it's like the idea, like when you have to teach it, even if I was teaching myself, you learn it a lot better because you actually have to describe why something works rather than like, well, you just type in this code and it does something and then it works. It's like, no, you have to really know why it works. So I did it sort of like as my own education. And then it got to the point where like I uploaded a couple to YouTube or something and people started watching it. So I thought like, oh, that's kind of cool. I remember the first time like I got 400 clicks to my blog to some article in one day, and I was like ecstatic. I couldn't believe it. I was telling my wife, I was so impressed with myself. Now it's like a low number. But back then, that was such a good feeling. So I was like, okay, well, I'll keep doing this because it benefits me. I sort of get to, set these little goal points as I'm learning, and then other people who may be a little bit behind me can start learning as well. And that's really how it happened. And then I got to a point where like a lot of people were reading this old blog, like nobody even knows what it was. It was called Detached Designs. That was my little company back then. I had no business running a company back then. Like I started this little freelance company when I had no experience whatsoever. And I was doing these projects that, like, I look back now and I think about these projects I did, and I should beat myself up. I had no business doing it. Here's an example of the first project I ever did. It's so depressing, too. I was trying to get some work, and I made some kind of Craigslist ad or something, and this woman approached me, and she runs, like, a custom urn. Like, when you die, you get buried in an urn. She wanted a website for that, so that was my first project ever. Oh, it was so bad. And the way I built it was, like, ridiculous. So basically, she sold, like, these, like, decorative urns, and she had 100 of them. I didn't put them in a database or anything. I just had them hard-coded. So I had, if she had 100 urns, I had 100 pages. And if we were going to paginate the results, well, I didn't actually do any pagination logic. I just had 10 pages of 10 urns. It was so bad. And she wasn't smart enough to know that I did a terrible job. But, I guess that's how we all do it. Anyways, that has nothing to do with your question. It just got to the point where this stuff was so hard for me that I created videos to document my learning, and people started watching them. That's about it.
So like, do you remember kind of your accidentally became a teacher?
One more time. I'm sorry, you're breaking up a little bit.
That's pretty good.
I can't hear you. You're breaking up a bit.
Can you hear me now?
How's that? Yeah, I can hear you good. Can you see me? Is that fine?
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. You were cutting out, but now you're back.
Sorry. So I live like it's crazy. I live in a place called Chattanooga, Tennessee, and we have some of the fastest internet on the planet. We were one of the first towns to get the gigabyte internet. But for some reason, the house we live in, like, it has all these, like, big walls, and I guess the material we used, I don't have really fast internet, even though we have the best possible. It's weird. Okay, go ahead.
That's okay. So you kind of accidentally became a teacher and doing this stuff. And I can really relate to that. Most of why I blog about some of the things I blog about is because it really forces you to understand it well, to be able to explain it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really good for people. Like, you don't have to create videos, but create articles and stuff. And I think a lot of people fall into this trap. I've seen it over and over. People fall into this trap where they think, well, I don't want to write an article that leads people down the wrong path, because I don't really understand this, so I don't want to write it, and then people learn from it, and then I give them bad advice. And it's like, you know what? I think to some extent we're all just giving bad advice, because all of us look back on the projects we did 5 years ago, even 2 years ago, and we think, oh, crap, what was I thinking, you know? So I think that's just a fact of life, but it still stands true. Like, if you write an article, you help yourself, and then you help the person who's a little bit behind you. Because, like, I always have this idea, like, development is so complex that none of us can contain it all. Like, some of us we're better at testing or server administration or more front-end stuff. So we all have, like, little pieces of the puzzle, and it's like we have to share it with each other because there's no way to keep up other than that.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And
like, what was your first project? Can you remember?
Oh, that's bad. It depends on what you consider my first project, because I mean, I made websites when I was like 13 before divs were really cool and like.
Okay, well, you got started way before me then.
Yeah, iframes were like a big deal because you could put the frames anywhere, and that was really exciting.
but do you remember the first thing that you made a little money off of?
Mm-hmm.
What was it?
So I was working at a newspaper as a web developer using Joomla, and I had a friend of mine call me up and ask if I could build a web application for a client she had. To which I said, of course I can, absolutely. And had no idea. I think I crammed as much information about MVC into my head in the shortest amount of time that I could possibly. I taught myself how to use CodeIgniter. It was really, really bad. I had no concept of Active Record or really, you know, everything was in the controller, and it was a mess. But it did end up working, and I learned a lot, so.
You know what, though? I, like, sometimes I still feel that way. Like some of the, I was looking at something I wrote a year ago, and it was like, man, that's not good. You know, and it was like, I've been doing this a long time. I feel like I understand what I'm doing. And it just shows like how much we're all growing very quickly. So it just shows like you look at stuff you did not that long ago, and it's bad. You know, and it's just how it is.
The way I look at it, though, if I look at my code that's older than, I'd say, a month, if I'm looking at something I wrote more than a month ago, and I'm not completely disgusted, that I'm not learning enough.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, I try. I'm actually rather happy when I go back and I look at it and I'm like, oh, why? Because it just means that, you know, that's progress.
Yeah, it's nice. It's nice when you can go back to your code, and when you read it, it's like, yeah, that's pretty much what you'd expect. Like, that's the best case scenario. You look at your code, and it's pretty much what you'd expect. I heard somebody mention that, like, in a conference years ago, and it's like, that's your metric for quality. It's pretty much what you expected, you know? But yeah, I built so many crap projects, and I guess we have to. My problem was I got paid for these, and I had no business to. Like, I had this story. The most dangerous project I ever made. Okay, so my mom is a professional songwriter, and she wanted to start this publishing business. So I was like, oh, sure, I can do this for you, because I knew what a div was at that point, so I was qualified to create a membership site. No, not at all. So it turns out, like, she wanted this thing, like, people, it's kind of like Lyricast, actually, where people would pay, I think, $25 a month, and then she would review their stuff, she would pitch their stuff to publishing companies. The specifics aren't really interesting. What is interesting, though, is when I built this membership site, once again, I had no business, I had no clue what SSL meant, I had no clue how to accept a credit card. Okay, so here's how I accepted a credit card. When somebody would fill out the form to sign up, they enter their credit card number, they submit it. I'm not sending it to like a third-party service like Stripe. That number is going in clear text to my server. I'm taking that number and just throwing it into a database. It's not being hashed or any. I shouldn't even be sharing this because it's so incredibly bad. But it was like 10 years ago. I'm much better now. But anyways, I took their credit card number, threw it into the database, and then I didn't charge that card like programmatically. Once a month, I would pick up a phone, and then I would call this number to charge a card, and I would just enter the card number for each member that signed up. It was so dangerous. Like, we could have been sued. It was so incredibly bad. I had no business, but I learned a huge amount, and we didn't get sued, luckily. But, yeah, it's a terrible story. And I hope, like, everyone has a story like that.
That's not what you're using for Lyricast.
No,
right?
it is what I'm using for Lyricast, but it's a little tweaked because we reversed the credit card number before it goes into the... No, of course, Lyricast is completely secure at this point, but I hope everyone has a story like that where they were so completely overwhelmed, because the truth is, like, as dangerous as that was, I learned more in that little six-month period than maybe I ever have, because, like, when you just get thrown in with the wolves, you have no choice but to stay up till 2 a.m. reading these books. Sort of like you were saying, where it's like you just have to get up to speed as quickly as possible. So it worked out well for me, but so, so dangerous.
Okay, well, you've come a long way since then, I think.
Thank you.
Most of us have. And excuse my dinging. It's not listening to my do not disturb. So today's just a whole grab bag of issues. Anyway, so you... not only are a pretty well-known developer, not only very successful, but you actually own your own business and you're self-employed.
Yeah.
So how did that happen?
Okay, so I was working at a company called Envato. If people aren't familiar with Envato, like we had the Tuts network. So if you ever read NetTuts back in the day, I ran that site. So I joined the company right when NetTuts was a baby, and I got to build that up, which was such a good learning experience. So I worked there for a while. Envato also runs like all these marketplaces, like if you've heard of ThemeForest, where you can buy like cheap themes and WordPress themes and like that. That's what Envato is really known for. But it got to the point where like I was doing a lot of the stuff on the education side, but like I don't know, it gets to a point where like if you stay anywhere too long, I think it's kind of a bad thing. I had been with the company for 5 years, and it was like I was wanting to work on different things. I was wanting to try out, you know, different skills that I didn't have. And the problem is you get to a company and you have your job. You know, it's sort of like a factory system. This is how you contribute to the company, and that's all you do. And that's cool for a while, but then if you want to like stretch your wings and do something else, there's really no room for that because you need to be the one doing this thing. So, I don't know. I wanted to... There was a lot of things with the product that we ran at Envato. It was called Touch Plus Premium that I wasn't a huge fan of, and I wanted to sort of have my own approach to it. So, yeah, it was very hard, to be honest. Like, I had a lot of conversations with my wife because when you go out on your own, it's like, hey, we're giving up our current income on the off chance that this little thing I'm interested in might do well. It's very dangerous and very scary. But, like, it was the site was going, Laracast, of course, was focusing on, like, Laravel and modern PHP development. And my instinct was, like, there's not enough education in this area. Like, if you look in the Ruby community, they have so much. They had Railscast and they had Destroy All Software. These really great videos specifically for like working professionals. A lot of the stuff in the PHP world is for people making their first website, you know? So I was like, I think there's a market for this. I feel like I want this. So if I want it, like I have to trust that other people want it. So I talked with my wife. I had to convince her. And yeah, we took the leap, and it ended up working out very well. Laracast has been growing nonstop. So, yeah, we're in a good place. And I hope it's helping the community. That's my hope, is, like, the PHP community has grown so much in these last 5 years. Like, for people who are just getting into it, like, back then, in 2000, even, like, 2010 even, it was bad. It was really bad. I was doing a lot more Ruby work back then because the PHP world was sort of, like, dark and depressing. We had CodeIgniter, but it wasn't being updated, and I don't know, there wasn't much innovation. All of the innovation was happening with on the Ruby side, and they had all this cool stuff like Heroku and Ruby Gems. It was so cool over there, and we had nothing, and then it just suddenly changed, and I'm very proud to be a PHP developer at this point.
As am I. So, you took the leap. That's a big leap. And you get your wife on board, which is a good thing. But why Laracast? Why not PHP casts?
Because it was mostly modeled off of Railscasts. That was sort of my inspiration. So if anyone's not familiar, it doesn't really... It exists now, but it's not updated. The person who created it, his name is Ryan Bates. I don't know what happened to him. It's kind of interesting, actually. Ryan just sort of disappeared. I don't know, like, if he had some family issue or he burned out. My instinct is he burned out. But the site is still live. It's railscasts.com. Let me double check. Yeah, railscasts.com. But it's just not updated anymore. Anyways, I learned so much from him, especially when I was doing a lot more Rails work. I would go to this site and watch these videos, and it was like they were tailor-made for me. Every little thing I needed to do, like even something as simple as, like, oh, how do I set up authentication, you know, even something as simple as that, he would just have a video for it. It was so useful. So when I was getting into Laravel, like I discovered Laravel, I don't know, a few years ago. I just saw a tweet about it, and this was right when Laravel 3 came out, actually. And I was kind of looking through the documentation, and I had this feeling like whoever created this kind of has it figured out because it felt good. I was coming off of CodeIgniter, and CodeIgniter got the job done. I think we'd all agree, like, CodeIgniter was cool in its time, but then it was like, there was just, if we all look back, it was bad, you know? But it was great at the time. We didn't have any other options. But Laravel just seemed to have everything figured out already. Like, everything I needed to build most of my projects, it was already there. So I was getting into it, and I was really trying to learn it, and, you know, it got to the point where I was writing a lot. I was writing magazine articles, because I get excited by stuff and I want to write it and pass it on. And so, you know, it's not much more complicated than that. Laracast is not specifically Laravel focused. It's just PHP focused, but I use Laravel as a base for most of the projects. And that's about it.
Okay, so I've used Laravel. I like Laravel. I've been to a couple Laracons now, so, you know, I'm definitely in that camp, but there are some out there that are not Laravel fans. And being that a lot of the videos you do aren't necessarily Laravel specific, but PHP specific, I've seen you doing some like command bus type videos and such. Have you ever had any negative kickback or negative perception of the product you're offering because it's Lara something?
No, actually, to be perfectly honest, nothing. You know, it's yes, it could be more general, but like you could say that over and over and over. Why are you doing PHP casts when you could be doing web development casts? Or why are you doing web development when it could just be development in general? At some point, it's a good thing that you have an area of focus. The people who are interested in building applications with Laravel probably aren't interested in, like, I don't know, Symfony tutorials or Fuel tutorials or CodeIgniter. So it's like at some point, it's good to have an area of focus. In fact, this is part of the reason why I left Tuts Plus. We got to the point where it's like we were publishing all of these video courses, which were cool. But it also got to the point where it's like, okay, we aren't for anyone. We're just for everyone. So it's like one day we would have something on Python. One day we would have something on print design. One day it would be PHP. You know, it was all over the place because we're trying to make everyone happy. So like on one hand, it's cool. You're a library. Just search for you want. Search for what you want, and you're probably good. But I realized that even though I worked for Tuts Plus, I wasn't using the site. You know, it wasn't for me. So I wanted to build a site that was for me and other people like me. And at that point, you need to have an area of focus, and there's nothing wrong with that. And honestly, nobody has ever complained about that.
Well, good. It seems to have worked out rather well. It's just something I kind of wondered. We do have a question off Twitter. From Dario Diaz, what recommendations could you give to start a side project while working a full-time job?
To start building a project while working full-time? Is that the question?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
A little bit every single day. That's the most I could. Like, I totally get it. You have a full-time job, and you have this idea that you think would be cool, but the problem is at the end of the day you're completely burnt out and you have no time to work on this other thing. Now like when you're young, you can kind of do it. You know, people, when you're young, it's like you don't have a family, you don't have kids, you can just work all day and then code at night on your side projects and you're good. But the truth of the matter is most people have families, they have children, most people burn out after 8 hours of work. There's nothing wrong with working 9 to 5, like some people say. So yeah, it does get hard where it's like, okay, I want to do this, but I don't have the energy for it. Really, energy is kind of what all of this comes down to. People who have more energy end up doing better. It stinks, you know, because we don't really maybe we do control it. I don't know, but it's the truth. So what would my advice be? Try to do like an hour a day. Like if you do an hour of work every single day, at the end of the year, that builds up so much. Like, I can give you a perfect example for Laracast. I built that for about, the first release was actually pretty basic. It took a few months to build up the content, and that all came from like an hour after work, maybe a couple hours on the weekend. But once you add that up over the course of 3 or 12 months, you have a lot going for you. Even at Laracast, like once I make the content and I do all the businessy stuff like reporting and financial stuff, I still try to put like a couple hours a day just to building the product. And when you do it, when you look at the end of the year, you have so much going for you. All of these various commits you have, where I think if you fall into that trap of, oh, I don't have time to do it, then you do nothing. But if you just try to do a little bit, it adds up pretty quickly. So that would be my advice.
That's some pretty solid advice. That's actually what I use for open source work.
Yeah, exactly, for open source work. Do 30 minutes, you know. Even if you do an hour a week, that's a lot. That means at the end of the year, you put 60 hours worth of work into free contributions. I think that's great.
I think your years are longer than my years.
Maybe.
We had a question. Now that Laravel 5 is coming out tomorrow, for anyone who didn't realize, ooh, Laravel is coming out tomorrow. Yay! Are you going to focus more on Laravel 5, or are you going to go back and forth between 4 and 5?
Totally on 5. Somebody criticized me the other day because I basically said there won't be any more Laravel 4 videos. And somebody was like, well, people still use it. And it's true. Like, Laravel 4 is not dated at all. If you don't want to upgrade your big app to Laravel 5, you don't need to right now. You know, it's not like something new comes out and you immediately have to upgrade. But from like an education standpoint, it makes no sense for me to focus on Laravel 4 at this point. It will just continuously date itself. It's the same reason there's no Laravel 3 content on this site. You know, I'm only one person and I can't do a Laravel 4 video knowing that in however long, 3 or 4 months, I'm going to have to switch it out for Laravel 5. So no, everything will focus on Laravel. Everything Laravel specific will be Laravel 5 at this point. And actually on that note, like if people do want to upgrade, you're going to invest 3, maybe 4 hours worth of work into bumping up from Laravel 4 to Laravel 5. So like on one hand, I've seen people complain about that a little bit. But the truth is like, okay, 3 hours of work, you have to do it once every year and a half, and then you're on the cutting edge of what I would say is the best PHP framework available. So I think there's no reason not to upgrade. So yeah, no more Laravel 4 stuff.
Okay, but you're going to
also, if I could just interject real quick, it's not like it's that different. Like the folder structure is different, there's some new components, but in terms of the API, it's almost identical. So it's not like people upgrading from Laravel 4 to 5, it's going to be this totally new thing. No, there's a couple different things, but the API, using Eloquent and service providers and stuff like that, it's identical. There's no difference there. Okay, sorry.
Okay, that's okay. Okay, so another question from Twitter. Oh, wait, real quick before I do that. So you're not going to be creating any new version or Laravel 4 content, but you're leaving all the stuff that's already there, right?
Well, it's going to be replaced at this. Like, it will slowly be replaced. Yeah, see, that's the thing is, like, well, I could do more Laravel 4 stuff, but I've done a year of it. There's, like, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of videos on the site. No joke. So it's like, there's no reason for me to keep doing it. I've already probably done it already. So new stuff is Laravel 5, and then I'm slowly going to be, like, redoing the old stuff when I have free time. That's how that'll work.
So next Twitter question. Somebody would love to know how you overcame your fear of recording screencasts and talking to your computer.
I didn't have a fear. I have tons of fears. I'm sorry, I'm reading people tweeting me. I shouldn't close that out. Okay, I have plenty of fears, but that's not one of them. Like, things that really make me nervous is speaking. I get very nervous about that. I've done it many, many times, and it does get easier, but it never goes away. I always feel that, you can't see it on the camera, but I feel that anxiety in my chest. That never goes away. In terms of screencasting, that's like the easiest thing in the world, because if I screw up, I just hit delete. So like, there's no issues with that whatsoever. I never had a fear of that. One thing would be, I think some people watch the videos and think I can just beautifully do it all in one take, and then I hit publish and we're done. It's not like that at all. I would love to be the person who could just type flawlessly, but like, we all have that stuff, like you're working and then suddenly your fingers just stop working. You know what I mean? And it's like you look at what you typed and it's illegible. Like that happens 10 times as much when you're recording a video because you're on camera and you have to speak eloquently, and it happens quite a bit. So yeah, like there's a lot of editing in these videos. But in terms of a fear or it making me nervous, not even an ounce.
Okay, but you still get nervous speaking.
Yes.
Right?
Oh gosh, I think it's a personality thing. You are either the type who gets nervous at a talk. Like I've met people on both sides, people who are like freaking out before their talk, and then people who it's like 10 minutes before their talk and you would never have any clue that they were even preparing or thinking about the talk. You know, it just comes down to personality at that point. I'm one of those people, like, I don't freak out, but it's just like when I'm on stage, actually, that's fine. That's golden. The part that's hard for me with speaking is the 2 months leading up to it. I'm just thinking about it all the time, and the anxiety just kind of just spins around like a twister. And then once I get on stage, it's gone like in a second. That part is easy for me. It's just the building up that never goes away. So I always have this, like when I agree to do a talk, I always think, like, why did I sign up for this? Because I hate the build up, especially like the day before. Like I always want to go first. On the first conference day, I'd like to speak, because when I'm the second day, like I just think about it the whole time the first day, and I hate that feeling. I hate it. But also, like I think it's good to force yourself to do this stuff. Like, the reason that it makes me uncomfortable is exactly the reason why I should make myself do it. So I think that's good, but to some extent, it doesn't really ever go away. You just get more comfortable speaking, but the build-up, you either have that or you don't. Like, you're speaking a lot now. Like, do you get nervous?
Oh, all the time. Constantly. I think the first time I ever spoke was at LayerCon US in New York, and I was literally about to pass out and or vomit prior to going on stage.
Yeah.
And then pretty much the whole time I was on stage, and then shortly after I got off, like, it was a ball.
Well, that's amazing, because I saw you, and you never would have guessed. That's what a lot of this stuff is, like, fake it. Like, even if you're dying on stage, fake it, and that's fine. Nobody knows what you're thinking inside, so you can just kind of project and act confident, even if you're, like, crying inside, and I think that's fine, you know? Put on the mask you want people to see.
Yeah, I mean, it works. Fake it till you make it. I think I've spoken at two-day conferences now, and I spoke on the first day at one and on the second day at the other. Mm-hmm. Much prefer the second day, I think.
Oh, you do? Mm-hmm. See, I prefer the first day.
See,
go ahead.
With me, it's kind of like, I think I spoke halfway through the last day at a conference. I think it was LayerCon EU, but I don't remember. And so I told myself, like, if you completely bomb this and it's totally awful, you just have to hide in your hotel room for, like, 6 more hours and then you can go home and you're done. Whereas if it were the first day, I'd be hiding for, like, a whole weekend in shame. So
see, my thinking would be, if I bombed on the first day, I still have to go back the second day. So actually, your plan works better than mine. Crap. But, yeah. But, you know, I also talk to a lot of people where, like, there's no chance they would ever speak. Where I say, like, you should go talk. And it's like, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not built for that. And it's like, no, that's why you should do it. You know, I don't know, when I first got into this, I had this idea, like, there's the good old boys club where it's the same people that speak every time and they think they're better than us. And it's like, none of it is true. It turns out the speakers, like, they would probably want more people to come talk to them. You know, in our industry especially, like, people are so nice. There is no sense of, like, these people are above us and we're not allowed to talk. That doesn't exist whatsoever. So there's no reason anyone shouldn't try to speak at a conference. Just find something that you feel pretty confident about. You don't have to be the best, and talk about it. But I get the anxiety aspect.
That's actually pretty much the entire reason why I made No Capes, because all these really prominent people look, I mean, they can look like they're up on a pedestal, and really, they're mostly just people.
Yeah, like, you had Uncle Bob on, like, last time. Like, he's been in this industry for decades. He's on, you know, people are cool in this industry.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun, and that was...
Because I think we all kind of appreciate that it's so... Once again, like, I just come back to this in every podcast I do. We all appreciate it's so hard, so we just have to help each other. And no one can ever get too cocky, because there's some section of this world that they know absolutely nothing about. You go to any, like, engineer's blog or website, and it looks like complete garbage. You know, it's like, and that's an area that they know absolutely nothing about. So, you know, we all have little pieces of the puzzle. It's cool.
Yeah. I love talking to new developers, like, because I very distinctly remember being right there. And so when I have someone come up to me and want to talk, and I'm like, yes, please, because I had people helping me, and let me help you.
Yeah. I think we all realize, like, even I've been doing this for 10 years or so, and it's like, I'm very well aware of how much I don't know. And I think, like, I don't know, like, before I got into development, I was actually studying guitar and classical guitar and all that. That was the plan, is I was going to be a studio musician. And I'd been doing that since I was 7 years old or so. I went to college for music. And I remember, like, I brought this up before, but it had a big effect on me. There was one point where I was getting kind of cocky, and my guitar teacher said something like, you don't even know enough to realize just how little you know. And I was offended at first, because it was like, I've been doing this for a decade. But he was completely right. Even after a decade of doing it, like, I was a baby in terms of these people who have decades and decades of experience. So that had such an effect on me, and the exact same thing is true for development. Even after 10 years, I have some things figured out. Like, the best thing I could say for myself at this point is I can build something without having to look up every single step. Like, that's a huge win when you get to that point. Like, in the past, I want to build something, and it's like, okay, step one, Stack Overflow. How do I do this? Membership, how do I do that? Okay, step two, how do I do that? Step three, you know, you just do it nonstop. And then you get to a point where it's like, okay, I kind of know how to do this. And then it gets to the point of how can I do this best, which is a good position to be in. I've forgotten your question completely. So
did I. So we're good.
I'm sorry. I have a tendency to ramble.
It's okay. It works. I do have a question, though, based on what you just said. Is there anything that you have to look up all the time?
Totally. No. Okay, that sounded cocky. No, I meant I don't have to do it quite as much. I spend plenty of time on Stack Overflow. And I think that's good. Like, you don't have to memorize the things that are very easily things you could look up. Yeah, oh, here's a perfect example from the other day. I was having to set up SSL for this new project I'm working on. I can't remember how to do it. You know, like, I can never remember what steps I'm supposed to do on the server. So, like, I have this Stack Overflow page almost bookmarked. So every time I just go back to it, and it's like, step one, DigitalOcean has this great article where it just shows you everything you have to do. Follow that, then do this, then do that, because I can't keep that in my brain. Nobody can, unless you're really into the server-y stuff. I have no clue. So, you know, that's the stuff I look up. I just meant in general, like, for basic things, like, how do I remember I wrote my first blog or something, and I wanted people to be able to like the post on the blog, like a star. I had no clue whatsoever how to do that. I spent 2 weeks on it just figuring out how to do that. It's nice when you get to the point where it's like, no, I know how to do that stuff. I don't have to look up every single detail of something.
Yeah, I only asked because I have PHP.NET date function in my bookmark.
Gosh. All the various letters? Totally. Mm-hmm. No, what person on the planet memorizes, you know, every single time I want to, like, format it as the month, the day, comma, the year, I have no idea. Is it, like, F for Y? You don't need to memorize that stuff. Yeah, yeah. Totally.
And array functions, too. I look up array functions almost constantly.
Yeah.
Like, is it needle and then haystack, or haystack and then needle?
There is a method to the madness, I'm told. Like, you know, that's one of the big things people go off on PHP about. It's like, you never know the order. Is it haystack or needle? And it's different every time. And it's like, actually, it's insane, but also there is some method to the madness. It's something like with arrays, it's always this, and with that, it's always that. But the problem is none of us really remember, so we have to look it up each time.
That's valuable brain real estate that I can use for other things.
Life is too short to fill your brain up with that stuff. But that's where it's nice to, like, use a good collection class. Like, if you're using Laravel or Symfony, both of those have a good collection class. That's sort of like a super array, an array on steroids, where the API is one that you can memorize. So I never have to remember things like, you know, array flip or whatever they are, because they're wrapped within some kind of object I can use instead. That feels a lot better. So that's one of the things, like, when people really attack PHP, they bring up stuff like that, and it's true, but then at the same time, any developer worth their salt is kind of using some of these abstractions so that it's not an issue at all. So I don't know.
Yeah, I actually pull in Illuminate support and do a lot of things that I do because I love the collection.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so a question, kind of neglecting. And real quick, I got a question for me, by the way. Yes, Mike, I prefer tidy cats, because I do. okay, so here's an actual question for you. So we're doing a Laravel revolution in the company I work for. Everyone has been doing procedural but me. Do you have any tips they should approach Laravel and or how to clear their mind of procedural stuff?
Oh, it's so hard. I don't know how to answer this in a podcast. It's a very long process. I was telling somebody the other day at a meetup in Arkansas, I was saying when I first started learning about object-oriented programming and this idea of how objects talk to each other, I thought I had it figured out. I was watching, back then, I was watching some video And some woman was saying how long it took her to figure it out. Like, it took her years to get it. And I was like, what are you talking about? This is easy. You know, I had it figured out in a couple months. And it turns out I totally understand what she was saying. I thought I had it figured out, but I had no clue how it really works. I just learned that you can new up a class, and then you call a method, and then just basically spit all of your procedural logic into that method, and ta-da, that's object-oriented programming. And of course, no, that's not it at all. So it took a really long time for me. That's the thing, is like, you don't read a book or watch a video and then you're good. You know, it's like a RPG, it's like a video game where it's like, you learn a little bit, and then you still screw up for a while, and then you learn a little bit more, and then you level up here, and you know, it's just this slow process of leveling up. I don't have any specific tips, I'm sorry. Just read everything you see, watch videos, read articles. That's all any of us do. We just read nonstop about this stuff.
I think it's it's a complete like cognitive shift to go from procedural to a more object-oriented approach. And the path that I see most people taking is usually take all of their procedural code and then throw it inside a class and call that object-oriented.
Right, which is what I did. Yeah.
Yeah. Not always the best approach.
Maybe it's a good first step, because it's like none of us do it perfectly. Probably we're not doing it perfect right now. But maybe it's a good first step. I don't know. The truth is, I think the way most people are learning object-oriented programming at this point is they learn a framework. They learn Symfony or CodeIgniter or Laravel, and it forces them to learn a little bit about objects. But even then, it's like, well, you're using objects, but do you really understand how it works and how they can expose behavior? And it gets very complicated pretty quickly. And there's no like shortcut. You know, I get mad at a lot of I run Laracast, it's an education site, but a lot of similar ones kind of brand themselves as learn how to code in 3 months and just take this class for 3 months and you're good to go. It doesn't work that way, like not even remotely. You can build your first website in 3 months, but the truth is like it's years and years and years, you know? And at the point where like I run an education place and I'm still learning all the time is just evidence enough. Like, you don't really stop. It's very difficult. You're going to be changing a lot. Your tooling is going to change a lot, so you have to dedicate so much time to learning new tools and stuff, and it's hard. But worth it.
I often wonder if other professions have this. Like, pretty much we're constantly learning, and if you're good at what you do, you're going to be constantly learning as a developer, I think. And I just don't know. Like, if I had gotten into basket weaving, would I always be constantly learning
things? Can you master basket weaving? That's a good question. We'll have to research that. No, I'm sure, like, doctors and stuff, they're learning nonstop. Lawyers, things, laws are changing all the time. It's probably true for most professions, but I don't know. Ours feels so hard. I get mad at our industry. It's so hard. A reason why Laravel specifically is so popular and Symfony is so popular is like they make things that are so complex a little more bearable. And that alone just says how hard it is. It's like they make it a little easier. And that's why we like them so much. Because without them, it's kind of like ripping your hair out. Like just the danger associated with it, you know, like security and stuff. Like, are you doing this right? Are you escaping everything? All of those things you have to memorize. We can't do it. So we have these tools that make the impossible actually doable. And I don't know, that says a lot about the industry and how hard it is that we require these tools.
Definitely glad that we have them, though.
Definitely.
Okay, so question from Twitter. Do you have a pre-lesson ritual?
Pre-lesson, like before I record?
Mm-hmm.
No. Hit record. That's kind of the ritual. If we're going to talk about like screencasting specifically, everyone does it differently. Like, so what some people do is they will write out a script, and then they will work on the script, and then they will do everything at once. Some other people will record the video, but they won't talk. They'll just kind of work on it by themselves, and then they'll do a second pass and then talk over it. My approach is just, this sounds bad. My approach is just hit record and start talking. I feel like that works out the best. I want it to feel as close as possible to like if I'm helping somebody out, it's sort of like they're sitting next to me. So it's like, okay, here, let's check this out. You know, that's what I want it to be. When you write a script, it sounds like a script, and nobody really wants to hear that. You know, at least I don't want to hear somebody speaking a script. I just want to hear a human being showing me how to do cool stuff. And the problem is, like, when I'm speaking, I make mistakes all the time, and that's where, like I said, the delete key is really good, because if I screw up a sentence, I'll just pause and I'll say it again until I get it right. So sometimes I'll edit out like five takes to get this stupid sentence right. But once you watch it and it's done, it sounds really good. So that's my approach. So in terms of a ritual, no, nothing.
So on average, say you're doing a 30-minute video, how long does it actually take to get that 30 minutes of good footage?
Usually it's double. So like 30 minutes is long. I try to avoid that. I have a couple that are 30 minutes, but like it's hard. Like, you're competing with Netflix and Hulu and Spotify for their attention. So when you get to 30 minutes, like, we all just lose interest, even me. I feel like 15 minutes is the sweet spot. We can keep our attention for that long. So if I do a 15-minute video, it takes about 30 minutes to record. And then once I edit it down, it comes to 15 minutes. Because, like, you know, like, sometimes you're working on something and your brain just freezes and you just sit there looking at your editor and you think, like, okay, I don't know what to do right now. And it takes a minute to gather your thoughts. The same is true when I'm doing a video, but I can just delete it so I look awesome. But really, I spent 10 minutes just trying to figure out why the stupid error was displaying, but you didn't get to see that part.
Have you ever thought about making, like, an outtakes reel?
Yes. We wanted to do that when I worked at Envato, and I think we just decided the reality is it would be so boring. You know, like when you watch movies and the movie ends and there's a hilarious outtake reel, I don't know if that transfers over to code very well, because it would mostly just be, like, me cussing just over and over, like, oh, crap, and then delete. So I don't know how enjoyable that would be, but I don't know. It might be fun.
Could be fun, yeah. Okay, so Nathaniel Johnson wants to know if you can talk about the new testing book that you're writing.
It's not new. Okay, so a few years ago, I wrote a book just on, like, testing specifically for PHP developers. Because once again, it's like, some of these things were, all right, in the Ruby community, it's like everyone does it. It's part of, like, the fabric of being a Ruby developer. It was not that way for PHP. You know, like, it's just how we grew. You know, it grew very much this little language specifically for the web, and then WordPress took hold, and that brought a specific type of person who just wanted to build little WordPress sites. Not being rude to WordPress, by the way, but that's just how it came up. And so testing was always something, like, I think even to this day, 80% of PHP developers don't test. But it's better than a few years ago when it was like 98%. So I wanted to write a book, kind of like Grumpy Programmer. He's huge in this area, to just evangelize the benefits of this stuff. So I wrote that. But the problem is that was a couple years ago, right? And once again, it's like things just move so fast. The truth is, a lot of that book, there's better ways to do it now. There's better tooling. When I wrote it, things like PHP Spec and Behat, they were around, but they weren't nearly as big as they were right now. So, like, those are what I use. But in the book, I'm actually, you know, just using different tooling. So, once again, like, things change so much, it needs to be updated. So, nothing huge to say on it. I'm working on it right now. It'll be better. That's about the best I can say. It's version 2 of a book that's already out. It'll be called PHP Testing Decoded. And, yeah, I need to get it done. I need to just, really, it's at the point, like, I need one weekend where I can just focus on it for, like, 10 or 20 hours, and it'll be done. It's hard writing a book because, like, I think anyone who's written a book will know, like, the hardest parts are by far getting started. Like, writing the first page is the hardest part by far. And then the final, what we think is, like, the final 5% of work actually turns into, like, the final 50% of the work. The final 5% of a book takes hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. So that's really hard. And then starting a book, like, I have, like, these other books I want to write, and it's like just making yourself sit down and start the first paragraph is almost impossible. Like, you have to force it. And that's why so many people just never bother. But it's a good reward. Like, the feeling of finishing a book is an amazing feeling. I think everyone should do it at some point or another. And then services like leanpub.com make it so easy. We're not at a point, especially as developers anymore, where you need a publishing company. You don't anymore. Just put it on LeanPub. You get like 90% of the profits. It's incredible. They give you the tooling so that it's auto-formatted and it looks really good. It's never been easier ever to just write a book and release it and make money. And it's a good feeling.
I definitely think so. And I have lots of friends that write books.
You should write one. Are you? You should write one.
No.
Would you ever do it?
No, I might. I might eventually, yeah. I used to write a lot of fiction, which isn't the same at all, but
maybe. Sure it is. What kind of fiction? Can we talk about, no? Off limits?
No, I mean, I was a teenager, and I was a very gothy teenager, so I wrote a lot of vampire fiction.
Nice.
Very Anne Rice, good times.
I like it.
Yeah.
Where can we buy these books?
Nowhere. There.
Can you put them on GitHub?
I have one binder in the back of my closet with all of that stuff, and that's where it stays.
So after the podcast, you'll put it on GitHub?
Right. I'll get that right
okay.
on
there. Let me tweet that real quick. Okay. Go ahead.
Okay, another question. A lot of people advocate testing religiously. Should we all be testing all the time?
No. Yeah, I don't know. I don't want to get in trouble. Okay, here's what I say. People like Uncle Bob would say, and I respect him immensely, he would say, like, he said this in the past, you're not a professional developer unless you practice test-driven development. I respect him so much, but I'm not sure how true that is, because so much of it just depends upon the project. There's certain types of things that lend themselves so incredibly well to TDD, you know, especially things like, when I feed it this, then this should be the output in that's how it is. That makes it really easy. I would always use TDD for that. But then there's other things where it's like, it's not so easy. So I would never want to make somebody feel bad if they didn't do it. Because you know what? The truth is, I know amazing developers that I look up to who don't like it. It's not their thing. But I think pretty much everyone would agree, you're better if you have some kind of testing for your project. It just makes you sleep better at night. There's no better feeling than finishing up work for the weekend, and you run your tests, you know, like PHP Unit or the Hat, and everything returns green. That is one of the best feelings. Like, if you want to, I say it's the ultimate sleeping pill, because it makes you just feel like, okay, everything's right in the world, everything works, there's no chance that the sign-up form where people enter their credit card is going to fail, because I have this test that proves it works. That is a very good feeling. So that would be like my only reason to recommend specifically testing. Now there's things like BDD where you're, you know, that's a little different. Testing is a nice side effect, but BDD is great for talking with a business and trying to start up a dialogue and making sure that when we can have like our code reflect the terminology that our business uses. And there's awesome benefits to that. But just talking about testing specifically, should everyone test their code? You know, if not everything is a big Amazon or an eBay. You know, like a lot of people are just building small internal projects for their company that will never really see the light of day outside of their company. And these small things, do they need tests? Maybe not. Maybe not. It just depends. Like, do the benefits of writing these tests outweigh the time they will spend on it? And there's going to be situations where the answer is no. It's not worth it. But I would say for most of your larger projects, especially projects that bring in money, why would you not do it? That would always be my question. Why would you not do it? It's not that hard. You just have to learn a little bit of tooling, and then you're good to go. What do you think? I'm more interested in what you think.
I think testing is very important. I personally prefer PHP spec to PHP unit, and that's how I write lots of things. I don't necessarily agree with all of the emphasis that's put on TDD specifically. You know, the red-green cycle is nice and helpful, but there are some cases where, I don't know, it doesn't necessarily need to be test first.
Yeah.
And that's just... And especially if you're working with a legacy code base, it obviously was not written test-driven. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't still write tests for it.
Legacy code is interesting.
I'm not religious about it either way.
Yeah. Here's the thing. I think sometimes our community can fall in the trap where we have really passionate people, and that's great. They're so passionate that they're tweeting all the time about what they think is right. But it's important to remember that plenty of people equally as passionate feel a different way. These things aren't completely black or white. Maybe some of it comes down to your personality. That's something I saw Taylor Otwell tweet, and I think that's valid, you know. Does some of this come down to, what feels right to you? That's really important. Even when working with an API or writing an API, what feels good? And is it possible that what feels good to you may not feel right to somebody else? And I'm not sure we should condemn people because something just doesn't click with them about that approach. But I don't know. People have to make up their own mind. I've seen massive benefits.
Yeah,
to do.
That's as a I've general seen. Rule.
Go ahead.
Yeah. As a general rule, I pretty much kind of shy away from anything that someone says religiously do all the time, no matter what, just because I do.
It takes no context. It doesn't take context into the equation. When we tell people, you should be doing event sourcing, well, really? What are you building? Maybe that should be the very first question. Rather than telling somebody the merits of event sourcing, well, how big is what you're building? There are plenty of very professional, awesome developers who have no clue what event sourcing is. I would have a little trouble with it. So when it comes to recommending that newcomers need to be doing this in order to be professional developers, I'm sorry, I think that's garbage. Learn about it, definitely, and when you get to the point where it's appropriate, use it, but just telling people you need to be doing this is terrible advice, in my mind.
Absolutely. Context-driven development. Let's do that.
Context. CDD. I like it.
Okay, so another question. Do you have any plans to expand your team? And what are your long-term plans for Lyricast?
No plans to expand the team. A few people have brought that up, make Lyricast bigger, where you have more people providing education. And it's on one hand, I think that's cool. But on the other hand, I think I would be reproducing the issue that I had when I worked at Tuts Plus. So it's sort of when you have all these different people creating content, you have more content. You have more clicks and more traffic, and that's good. But also you end up in situations where it's if you have 10 people contributing, you have 10 different points of views. And many times they contradict one another. So as a student, that becomes really hard. So it's this guy says do that, but this guy does it a completely different way. And that's just the reality of code, but I'm not sure that's what I want to represent on Lyricast. I kind of like the idea, look, this is what I've learned. If you like it, good. If you don't, fine. There's sites like Lynda. Sites like Lynda are great. They already have that. That's not what Lyricast is for. Lyricast is like Railscast with Ryan Bates or Destroy All Software with Gary Bernhard. That's the kind of format I'm interested in, not something where I have a big team. And then also just the basic idea that when you have a team, you have to have a team. You have to manage a team. That takes time. And the reason why I left my last job is because I was tired of doing that. I was tired of having meetings and then agreeing to, 2 weeks later, return to the subject and then have another meeting. I hate that stuff, I wanted to get away from that. So I'm happy with Lyricast being smaller. There's so much content on the site. I do one video a day, during the work week. That's enough, I think.
Yeah, it's a good amount of content, I think.
But yeah, it would be cool if I had lots of other people, but it's not what we're doing.
You could always have, cameos.
I could. Now, would a cameo be, a photo of them in the bottom left corner?
Yes, exactly.
I should do that.
Totally. So here's a question. Having reported on Laravel since the early ages, has it shaped up as you imagined, and what was your initial impression?
Okay, initial impression was, I said this, I think, earlier. My initial impression was somebody tweeted it. I saw this site called Laravel. It was version 3. I was looking through the documentation. And first, the documentation was fantastic. And I was looking at the API, and it just felt good. That's what I was saying earlier, with personality. I think some people in the PHP world, they use Symfony, and it feels right. And then some people use Laravel, and that feels right. It's even hard to describe what specifically it was. But what I can tell you is, like, being friends with Taylor and worked with him on a couple things, like, he spends so much time focusing on the API, like, hours and hours focusing on what we call a method. And I learned so much from that personally, because it shows so much. The reason why people like Laravel is because it feels good, and it feels good because hours and hours and hours were spent on that API. And most people don't do that. Like, really, most people don't do that, and it very much shows. So the second part of the question, has it turned out the way I wanted? It's a better question for Taylor. Has it turned out the way he wanted? I'm pretty sure he would say yes. But Laravel 5 will be out tomorrow, and I think it's far and away the best release and the best work he has ever done. Laravel 5 is really, really in good shape. So I think people will be excited. I think at the moment people are excited but a little nervous because there's some changes. The folder system is different. There are folder names that they don't immediately know what they are, like middleware is kind of a new concept, or things like commands and handlers I think scare some people, but having used it for quite a while, it's like you don't need to be worried about any of that stuff. You can still build applications as simply as when you were working with Laravel 3, but also if you're building large scalable applications, you're good to go too. So I think it's in a really good spot. I'm very happy with what he's done.
I'm pretty excited for it. So tell me, you know, being that you do Laracasts, you pretty much know all the Laravel things before everyone else. How cool is that?
It's pretty fun. It's fun. I've gotten to build up kind of a good friendship with Taylor, and sometimes I get a sneak peek at things, and I get to see like what he's thinking. It's fun. He talks to plenty of people. It's not like just me, but yeah, it is fun to kind of get a peek behind the scenes at what's coming around the corner. And it's good because I'm the type, like, I get very excited and I want to talk about it. And like, I had this problem. Okay, back in August, Taylor was demoing Laravel 4.3. And then it turned out, like, okay, we're not going to do 4.3. We're going to do 5.0. But I was so excited by 4.3, and I thought it was coming soon, that I recorded all these videos for Laracasts. This is, like, one of my big mistakes. So I record these videos, and then it turns out that he's going to bump it up to 5. Smart move. But for me, it was like, well, I had all this content, and now it's all irrelevant because he switched the folders around. You know, it was all completely my fault because I got excited and I jumped at the gun, and that was a big mistake I made. So I basically had to, and I am, re-recording all of that stuff I did at that point. So I don't know. Maybe, like, as an educator, that's the downside, is I want to cover this stuff. But the upside is, like, I think we worked out a good system where I don't cover anything until he gives me the okay. Like, this is in a good state where you can cover it. And then is when I create all the content for Laracasts.
Do you ever find the times when, like, you know something and you want to talk about it? Like, it's, I don't know, it's kind of a secret and you can't share it. Do you ever find that? No?
Oh, totally. Like, I want to share something on Laracasts, but I can't?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, all the time. Like, tons of stuff. I learned about there's this scheduling feature in Laravel where it just makes it really easy to, within your code base, schedule console commands that will be executed, which is awesome. It's just built into the core. I found out about that, and I was so excited, but he hadn't yet revealed that. I got to work with him on Laravel Elixir for a few weeks or a month before we announced it. That was fun. So yeah, like, it's pretty exciting. And you know what? The truth is that anyone can do this stuff. Like, if you want to contribute, just contribute, you know? It's hard. I think people feel like they want to help out with these projects, but they don't feel skilled enough to submit a PR. And the truth is, like, fix a mistake in the documentation. You know, like, that is contributing, correcting a typo or adding some bit of documentation that maybe wasn't clear, or some part of the API that's not represented in the documentation. That alone is a big help, I would say. So there's all these different ways to contribute. Write an article, make a video, create some documentation, submit a PR. There's so many different ways you can help out. It's crazy.
Yeah, speaking of documentation specifically, I saw Matt Stauffer yesterday, I believe, tweeting about documentation for Laravel. So somebody go find Matt if you're interested in helping with that and say hi. Okay, another question. How do you keep your ideas fresh in terms of new lesson ideas or blog ideas?
Yeah. Well, some of it is just, well, when I first launched the site, I just had a massive list. I mean, if you think about, like, okay, I want to help people become better developers, you could make a massive list of everything you want to cover. Everything from just fundamentals. You know, the fundamentals of object-oriented programming is what some people may take for granted. Other people are really much, really struggling with. That's a massive, you could do 20 videos. You could do 50 videos on just basic OOP. And then there's everything else, from security to testing to just understanding how a framework works, to design patterns, to design principles. It's like a never, that's sort of what I mean, is like we never can stop learning, because you could create 10,000 videos and there would still be other stuff to cover. It's just a truth in our industry. What was the question again? I'm rambling again.
How do you keep your ideas?
Okay. And then the other part of it is like building stuff. Like, I'm always building stuff. I'm building Laracast the product. I have some of these packages I build. I have some side projects that I'm working on. And from my experience, it's like you're working on this stuff. You hit some kind of hurdle where something didn't work. That is a perfect example of, for me, a video I should record, or for anyone else, an article you should write. A perfect example is recently I'm working on, well, I've already released it. I was working on business subscriptions for Laracasts. So people can sign up, and it's like you sign up your team, you can add 10 people if you're choosing and swap them out, give them access to the site. So that's what I was working on. And I was using Behat, but like I was having trouble getting it to work. Specifically, Behat and Laravel 5 was a little weird. So it was like, okay, well, this needs to be easier, because the reason why more people aren't doing it is because it's too hard. That's just the simple truth of it. If it's too hard for them, they don't have enough hours in the day, they got to get the job done, so they just throw that out. So I started working on a package to make it easier, like an extension for Mink that specifically works with Laravel. Like in the Symfony world, they have a Symfony extension for Behat. So now we have one for Laravel. So that was a perfect example of hitting a hurdle, wanting to fix it, and then once it was fixed, you have a perfect video for me to do. And then I did a couple of videos on Behat and using this extension. So, you know, these things kind of naturally come. I'm always worried that I'm going to run out of content. Like, every month I think, okay, I'm out of ideas. And there's always more to do. And when there's not, like, there's little projects. Just build a project together. I think people want that all the time. They just want to sit with somebody and build something. And it's amazing there just isn't that much content on the web for that. And the reason is because it's really hard. Like, if you think about even a basic project you build, it takes a long time, and it's a lot of trial and error, and it's a lot of toying around. So when you try to condense that into like a series of videos, it's pretty hard, which is why almost nobody does it. But if you can pull it off, I think it's a good resource.
Definitely. Okay. Good. Okay, one more question. We have several more until you have to go. You say the phrase tailor-made a lot. Is that a conscious thing?
Is it a conscious thing? Totally. Yes. I get mad that Taylor doesn't use that more, in fact, because it's awesome. That would be kind of arrogant for him to say things were tailor-made. So yeah, maybe he should not say it. But yeah, it's just kind of a fun thing. Every once in a while, like he'll show off something new in Laravel, and he'll just do a video himself that I put on Laracasts. So I have to tag it, and I can't think of a better tag than TaylorMade. So that's it. Nothing more complex than that. I think it's funny.
It's a fun play on words. Okay, Jake Smith wants to know why you don't attend/speak at many conferences.
I do. I've been at quite a bit. In my life, I've done, I don't know, I've spoken at maybe 10 conferences. But, like, and I did a meetup last month where I spoke about some of the new stuff in Laravel. But the truth is, like I was telling you, I don't necessarily enjoy it. I do it because, like, I force myself to, and I think it's, like, good for me. But in terms of like speaking, I just don't love it that much. You know, conferences are hard because I think it naturally attracts a very specific personality type. You have like the extroverted people who want to get and meet new people, and that's great if you're that type of person. But then there's like the type of person where you kind of prefer smaller groups, and the whole idea of like meeting a bunch of strangers and going to a bar and talking with them may not be like the most enjoyable thought in their head. People don't talk about this quite as much, but like, I feel that way. I don't know. Like, I feel a little introverted. Like, it takes me a long time to get comfortable with somebody. So, all right, here's an interesting tidbit. Speaking at a conference, when I'm on stage, it's infinitely easier for me than socializing with a bunch of 50 people that I've never met before. Infinitely easier. And it's just a character trait. You're either that way or you're not. I don't even know if most. I always wonder, like, the whole idea of, like, extrovert versus introvert. Before the internet, like, did introverts just think they were awkward people? Like, now we kind of understand, like, oh, no, like, this is just a personality type, and lots of us are that way, and you're not a bad person. If you'd rather go home than go to a big party after work, you know, you're not a bad person. But back then, we didn't really have all of this data accessible, so I wonder if we all thought we were just awkward weirdos. I don't know. I have no idea what I'm talking about.
I think before the internet, I was in elementary school, and yes, I did think I was an awkward weirdo.
I think I did too.
Yeah.
So would you say you were introverted? How do you feel about that?
I used to think that I was really introverted, mostly because I was really nerdy and I didn't have a whole lot of friends. But it turns out I actually really do like being around people. I just like being around people that
are like you.
Are like me. So I really enjoy going to conferences and meeting people. And I think when I went to Laracon US, that was my first conference. And I remember standing in line for lunch, and there was just this ambient nerdery in the air. You know, you could just pick up like little pieces of conversation around you, and it was all just so much nerd.
Yeah, that aspect is cool. Like, it seems like if you are attracted to our industry, you kind of like the same things, even things outside of our industry, and that is very fun. And I love hanging out with people who I've gotten to know. It's just for me, like, hanging out with strangers and socializing, and like for me, small talk is like the hardest thing in the world. I hate small talk so much. I love talking with friends that I know, and we can go to coffee shops and hang out, but like small talk with somebody I don't know is so hard for me. And you're either that way or you're not, and I guess the internet showed us you're not a bad person either way. It's just a personality trait, how you were born.
See, I'm thinking we should make some service where introverted speakers can, like, I don't know, telecall into a conference and give their talks like that.
Yeah. Like, all right, here's what I read. Like, the best metric for if you're an extrovert or an introvert that I've read is like, okay, let's say you have a long day of work and it's 8 o'clock. When you get off work, would you best recharge by going home and like seeing your family? Is that how you recharge? Or do you recharge by going out with friends and going to a restaurant or a bar? And it's like everyone splits down in the middle on that one. So like when I was in college, my best friend, like that's what he wanted to do after work every night. It's like, let's go out and hang out and recharge. But for me, like recharging was, no, I've been at work for 10 hours. I've been surrounded by people for 10 hours. I'm done. I'm going home. And that's how I recharge. So it all comes down to like how you best recharge after a long day.
Yeah, I've heard that. Or where you draw your energy from. It's either
from
being alone or from being with people.
Same idea.
Ben Ramsey says you should come speak at Nashville PHP, by the way, which isn't really a question, but it was tweeted.
Yeah, I used to live in Nashville. That might be fun.
Yeah. Okay, so what is your best method for staying in the zone and avoiding burnout?
Yeah, I worry about this a lot. Like, do you feel, you personally, do you feel overworked? Like you spend too much time on the computer? Or do you have good boundaries where it's off?
Okay, so I don't feel overworked, but that's because I'm kind of a workaholic.
So you are overworked then.
Yeah, I mean, I don't feel like burnout, but I do know that I spend probably, I don't know, 12 to 16 hours a day-ish.
That's overworked. So, yeah, I guess that's the worry. It's like, we do it because we like it, you know, so it doesn't feel like you're overworked because you're having fun. This is, you know, plenty of us before we got a paycheck, we were doing this for free. I was that way. But I guess the worry is, like, eventually you can't just keep doing it nonstop. Or maybe you can, but my instinct is you can't keep doing it nonstop, and will you burn out at that point? I don't know. I have temporary burnout a lot. Like, I especially if I'm working on some kind of new feature or some kind of product I'm working on, I have a tendency to, like, obsess over it, where it's like, some people will just say, okay, I'm going to put this aside, get a good night's sleep, and then the next morning we'll tackle it. That doesn't work for me. Like, I would much rather stay up till 3 in the morning and get it done, which is bad, I think, honestly, but that's sort of my approach. Like, I'd rather get the term paper done at 3 in the morning rather than get up at 6 in the morning and finish it. Once again, that's sort of a personality type thing. Yeah, I don't know. What's the question again? I keep forgetting this stupid question.
Tips for avoiding burnout and staying in the zone.
Yeah. How was I talking about term papers for tips for staying in the zone? I don't have any tips. Who has tips for this stuff? You just do your best. You have to know when to turn it off, right? Like, I find sometimes, like, if you do it too much, the truth is that the code you're writing is crap, you know, and you may not see it right now, but you're going to come back to it on Monday and you're going to think, oh, this is junk. So you do get to a point where it's like you're not producing anything of quality at that point, and you just don't know it, but that's the truth. But there have been plenty of nights where I'm in bed at 1 in the morning trying to work on something. I've deployed code at 4 in the morning. Like, it's stupid. It's idiotic for me to do that. But once again, it's like sort of personality types. I have no tips.
I think you and I have had conversations about this with the laptop in bed stuff.
Yeah. I brought it up. Okay, so I also get to be like a guest host on the Laravel podcast. And we were talking about this, and they made me feel like a complete fool. Because I brought it up, and I was like, do you guys ever like find yourselves working in bed on your laptop? And both Sean and Taylor were like, nope, I would never do that. And I know they're completely lying. But I'm going to call them out live right now. They were both completely lying because everybody is in bed working at some point on a project. So it's just you and me, you and I, we admit it and everyone else lies about it.
We're honest. That's what it is.
Yeah, we're honest.
I think for burnout, I don't know if I have any tips, but there was a time last year when I was working 2 jobs. So I was not only on my computer for 15 to 16 hours a day, but I was actually like working 15 to 16 hours a day. And that was exhausting, and I burned out on that and did not have a good time towards the end. So I think it's not just that you're like on your computer and not necessarily just that you're developing, but what you're doing probably matters. Because now, you know, I work a normal day, and then once my kids are in bed, I'll do open source or just playing around with something new. And that doesn't burn me out. But working the same amount of hours for an actual job really did.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it matters what you're doing, whether you enjoy it, and also whether it's optional, because, I mean, if I didn't want to one night, I just wouldn't, as opposed to a job where you have to.
Yeah. Well, one thing I worry, like, I don't have kids yet. Like, my wife and I will probably have kids this year, in fact, which I'm terrified about. So one of my worries, I would love to talk to you about this, one of my worries is, like, when I have kids, I'm not going to be able to keep up the way maybe I can now. Like, right now, it's like I can do my job, I can do side projects, and then I also have time where, like, I can keep up to date and read books. I'm worried that, like, when we have kids, I just won't be able to do that. When you had children, was that an issue? Did you feel like you couldn't stay up to date, or is it a non-issue?
Well, my situation is a little bit particular. I had my daughter when I was 18.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a single mom most of my time through college, getting my degree to become an end software person. So I kind of always had kids the whole time I've been doing this. So I guess I didn't ever lose anything per se. I just kind of modeled my life around already having children, and now I have 3, so between getting my career or my degree and then starting my career, I was continually making people. And I find that you kind of have to pick some things. So for me, like, I have my job continuing education, my kids, kind of sleep as the four things I have to pick from, really, that I want to do. And generally, sleep loses for me. I don't sleep a whole lot.
Do you think you're an insomniac? I feel like I'm an insomniac all the time.
Oh, yeah. I'm an insomniac and, like, medicated and still can't sleep.
Yeah, I'm the exact same way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's not too bad for me to miss out on sleep, but once you have kids, you definitely have to choose. And right. You'll have a whole lot of flexibility, and I have a lot of flexibility now. You know, I'm not self-employed, but I work remotely. So, you know, I can work at 3 o'clock in the morning without a problem if I need to, and I can also take off in the middle of the day to go to a recital or, you know, do kid things.
Yeah,
so
that is nice.
That's really important, and you should have that flexibility there.
Yeah, and I'm definitely thankful, like, especially since, like, remote workers is so much of a thing now. Like, when I started, it was, like, 5 years ago, and it was still sort of, like, this new thing, you know? It's not that way anymore. So it's nice, like, when we do have kids, I'll be home so much more. You know, my dad was, like, gone all the time for work, and he'd have to go on business trips for a week or two. So it's nice, like, we have jobs where we can be with our kids, even if it's just us on the couch with a computer while they're playing. That's something that, at least my parents, we never could have had.
Yeah. I think, who was it? Just have a baby. I think it was Brian Gallagher was talking about that because he just had a new baby. And I suggested that he put the baby, you know, because they roll around on the floor, and get a iPad. And then he could develop while doing FaceTime with his child. It would be great.
Fun. I like
yeah.
it.
See, technology. And funnily enough that you brought that up, because we actually had a question on Twitter that I wasn't going to ask, asking when you plan to have children and whether or not you want a boy or a girl.
Gosh, that was a question?
Yeah, I skipped over it, but I guess it's relevant.
I'm 30. I'll be 30 in a couple weeks. The plan was to have children when we were 30. So we were lucky enough that we're at a point now where I feel like we're ready to have kids. So this is so weird we're talking about this. yeah, we'll have children this year. So 2016, I'll probably have an infant. And then in terms of how many, this is a very specific question. 2 or 3? I don't know.
Girl or boy?
I would love a girl first.
I think in either case, though, you can definitely name it Taylor, and it's, like, safe.
That would be the creepiest. I've thought about, like, we think all the time, what is the creepiest name we could pick for our families? And so maybe I'll tell Taylor that. That's really creepy, though. So.
Yeah, my youngest son is named Sean McCoy. So I've had a couple people ask me, like, did you name him after Sean McCoy? No.
No, not quite. No.
My dad's name is also Sean, and that's who he's named after.
But yeah, I hope we have a daughter. My family is, like, all men. Like, we have one girl with 5 boys. So the chances are very high it'll be boys. So we hope we get a girl.
Girls are fun, and they're way, way easier. Way easier. Boys are something else. We had another question. I'm looking. Hold on. Sorry, I lost my place, and that is always upsetting. Somebody asked that you tweet the link to the SSL that you were talking about.
No, it's not.
Here's the question I'm looking for.
The SSL that the
what
the website I built that was really bad with the credit cards, no, it died almost instantly. Like 3 months later, it was gone. Like, I would keep that alive right now.
No.
Am I thinking of something else?
No, the article that you. Yeah, the Stack Overflow that you were talking about when you were setting up SSL.
I thought he was asking.
That you had almost bookmarked.
The stupid website I built where I was manually entering the credit cards, if I had a link to that. No, that was gone in, like, 1990-something. Let me find it. Well, I mean, I guess just Google Stack. I don't know. I'll find it later and tweet it. But yeah, it's a good reference.
Let me Google that for you.
Yes, I'll send somebody a link.
Okay. How quickly do you pick up a completely new concept for development in general?
I don't know. Like, can you label it like that? From my experiences is you get little bits and pieces. Like the first time I read a JavaScript book, I got to chapter 3 and I stopped reading it, because like chapter 1 and 2 were great. I had the concept of variables and loops, even though I still didn't even really understand why you would create a variable or why would you ever loop over something. These are like completely new concepts to us. We forget how hard the most basic things were. But I got to chapter 3 and I was like, oh god, this is like way too hard, which probably just means it was a bad book. But at chapter 3, I put the book up and I stopped reading it. So I've already forgotten the question, by the way. But what's the question?
How quickly do you pick up new concepts generally?
This is my problem, is I talk about unrelated stuff and then I forget. How quickly do I pick up unrelated? A long time. It takes a long time. Like I was saying, it's like an RPG where like you get a little bit of it, and then sometimes it makes, oh yeah, here's where I was going. Okay, I got this. So like I put the JavaScript book up, and then I went over to something else, and then I came back to the JavaScript book, and I found like that's the best way to learn, is work on something, go as far as you can, like stretch your limits, and then you're going to hit a point where it just completely becomes foreign to you, and then put it aside, and then work on something else, and then you'll come back to it. And that's the only way I've ever been able to learn some of this new stuff. Here's a good example. The famous blue and red books on like domain-driven design. To this day, I struggle with it. It's really hard. So I've read both of them, but it's like I haven't really read them. You kind of take in as much as you possibly can, and then I think most of us hit a point where it's like, ooh, I had no concept of how to actually apply any of this stuff, you know? But these are references. It's like you go as far as you can, and then you do another year of work, and then you come back to them, and then you go as far as you can, and it'll be a little further, and that's how we all learn. I have this problem at Laracast, actually, where people ask me for like a roadmap. Like, just tell me what to learn in order to be a professional developer. And it's the hardest thing in the world for me to deal with, because like it doesn't work that way. Like, you learn a little bit, and then the truth is that like once you get to step 3, just build lots of stuff, you know? Just build 10 things that you'll never use, and then you can start learning this. But the problem is like we all learn a little different, and what somebody might take to initially, the other person doesn't understand. And it's like I felt when I was learning all this stuff, it was just a constant like 50 books, and I at any time, I'll have 3 books on my bedside that I'm trying to understand. I don't know. What's your advice? I don't care about what I think.
I can maybe show you. Maybe. Let's see what this is. So when I learn, I have these. And this one's empty, but the one I just finished is somewhere. So I actually pen and paper things. Now, granted, what I've been learning recently is machine learning, so it's mostly math.
I saw that. Why are you focusing on that so much? For fun or for a project at work?
For fun, mainly. I work for a newspaper, so I would love to use some of these things at work, but I need to deeply understand them to be able to pitch that effectively to my boss. And also because I'm giving a talk at Sunshine for it, so that was good.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yes, anyone going to Sunshine, I will be there. Come say hi. I've always been a math nerd, and you know, when I got into web development and PHP and such, you know, I came from WordPress and Joomla into CodeIgniter, into Laravel, etc. You know, web development isn't really engineering, I don't think,
no.
Per se. You know, we're building websites, we're building web applications, but it's not what you think of when you think of a computer scientist, I guess. So I had kind of completely forgotten that computers are math, because that's, you know, that's not what we do every day. We're not writing algorithms to calculate things. And then recently I relearned that, oh, right, computers are math. And that's kind of really amazing, and I've always loved math, and I love computers, and so let's mash those together. I do that with pen and paper in notebooks.
So your approach is you take lots of notes,
mm-hmm.
and that helps you, like, remember it? Do you find yourself going back to the notes a lot, or does the process of writing the notes almost commit it to memory?
I do go back to the notes a lot. I actually go back to my notes when I'm writing blog posts, and when I'm writing, you know, the talk, I use the notes heavily. But also, it's a good... I annotate my notes a lot, so I'll write down things, and then I'll, like, highlight what I don't understand, and then when I get to that later, I'll go back to where I highlighted it, and I'll say, like, see page 75. And I kind of cross-reference back and forth in my notes that way. And I also really enjoy going through what I call, like, rabbit holes, where I'll start on a subject, and then when I come to something I don't understand, I'll highlight it, research that for a while. Somewhere in there, you know, I'm going to find another thing that I don't understand. And so I just keep falling deeper into these rabbit holes. I read a lot of academic papers, which are amazing. And I just recently spent about $100 at this antique bookstore buying, like, math and logic books from, like, the 50s and 60s and before. Oh, wow. And they're amazing. They're so amazing. And just amazing.
It's great.
Yeah. So
your advice for the question is much better than mine.
Yeah. Well, I guess, I mean, it really comes down to do what works for you. What works for me is pen and paper.
Yeah, I would guess the main thing is, like, just do it. Like, just spend a lot of time working on it, and if you want to take notes, or, like I was saying earlier, my version was, like, creating a video to make myself remember. Just do whatever you need to do, but the main thing is just keep going. Like, did you ever feel when... Well, you got started so much earlier than me, so maybe it's different. Like, when I was first getting started, so much of these... like you were saying, you learn something, you want to figure out how to do something. So you research that, and that sends you somewhere else, and that sends you somewhere else. And then before you know it, you're researching something to the point where when you figure it out, you don't even realize why you were figuring out how to do that.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know. It's hard.
It's hard. I really think... the absolute best, though, better than the notes, better than the pen and paper, the best way for me to solidify any knowledge is writing a blog post about it or a talk or...
document it in some way.
Pretty much having to explain it to another person is so much harder than, like, understanding it yourself, and it really forces you to, like, deeply understand whatever it is you're talking about.
So. Yeah. I'm looking at a tweet from Zach who says, I've definitely never worked from my bed, ever. Okay, thanks, Zach. Appreciate that. Okay, next question.
Sorry, I'm tweeting.
You know, I think, again, it's like a personality thing. I definitely don't think people should. Like, I would prefer not to. Let's make that clear. I don't think it's healthy, but people are the way they are.
And a lot of it, honestly, is going to be dependent on your spouse or... and or bed partner, because I think some of them are probably more tolerant to that than others.
Well, like, I guess it helps us, because, like, for me, my wife is one of those people, she puts her head down and she's asleep in 30 seconds. It drives me nuts, because I will, like, lay for 2 hours and nothing, and she'll be asleep in 2 minutes. So actually, from that perspective, it works out well, because if I can't sleep, I might as well get some work done versus just watching, you know, The Office over and over and over.
Definitely. Better use of your time. Okay, so we have two more questions, and we are way over time, so I'm going to ask these two, and then we need to wrap up.
Okay.
Question, do you use any ORM other than Eloquent?
At this point, like, for PHP, no. Honestly, no. Like, I think a lot of people are very intrigued by Doctrine. It seems like people split down the middle on this one. Like, do you like Doctrine, that approach, or do you prefer Eloquent? They're kind of different mindsets. I'm of the mindset, like, at all times, keep it as simple as you possibly can. So from that perspective, there's so much to like about Eloquent. It's laughably simple. Now, some of the downsides are very valid, but my worry is that, once again, people are being encouraged to take approaches that I'm not sure are necessarily appropriate for what they're working on. Like, I think some of these, especially Doctrine, has huge benefits for when you're building large stuff. But the majority of people are building small to medium-sized stuff. And from that perspective, I haven't seen these massive downsides to using an active record approach like Eloquent. Plenty of people have, and more power to them. But from my approach, The Active Record style keeps it simple, and that is more important than almost anything to me. How can we keep the code as simple as humanly possible? But yeah, I've done a lot of stuff. I've used, when I worked with Rails a lot, I've, of course, using their implementation. Played around with a lot of stuff. But eventually, you know, you just have to pick one that feels good to you. And I wish we didn't make each other feel bad about our choices. It's always one of my concerns.
Tool shaming is so much fun.
Tool shaming, yeah.
So I would say my opinion on that, I think this is the most opinions I've ever shared on No Cape. So I think that developers should learn to use Active Record and Data Mapper patterns because they're both valid patterns for different, you know, uses. So you should know what they are and know how to use them so you know when it's appropriate to use them. Personally, when I looked at Doctrine, I found it kind of overwhelming the first time.
It's totally overwhelming.
But Spot 2, I think it's by Vance Lucas, if I'm not mistaken, is a little bit kind of smaller scale data mapper pattern, which I have had success using, and I've seen some other people using it as well. So that might be a good way to dip your toes in the pool. But I definitely think it's a good idea to understand both patterns and why they're good. I think CodeIgniter actually did a decent amount of harm by kind of abducting the word Active Record without really super being Active Record.
Yeah.
Because I really thought when somebody asked me in an interview, like, do you know about Active Record design pattern? I'm like, sure, like, yeah, CodeIgniter uses that, absolutely. No.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I do worry, like, it's almost a like people, talking about Doctrine specifically, I think it's almost a badge of honor that when you first are introduced to it, it's like you don't like it. I've seen people tweet about this, and then it's like, and then you grow to love it, and you can't live without it. Okay, that's great, but I think it's a big concern that the majority of people's first impression of Doctrine is to push it away. So I think if the evangelists in that area want more people to use it, then show people the benefits and how easy it is to use, because plenty of people try it out and it's like, oh my gosh, if we're talking about Eloquent versus Doctrine, Eloquent is just laughably simple, and then we use Doctrine and it's like, I cannot remember what to do without following this very confusing guide, it's too complex, I'm going to push it away. That's what most people do. I think there's massive benefits to it, but I think that's a huge downside that people feel that way. So yeah, I would say like you need more education in that area. I hear Ross Tuck is writing a Doctrine book. I can't wait to read it. You need more stuff like that to if they want to evangelize that Doctrine. All right, here's the thing. I worry that people would say like Doctrine is always preferable to Active Record and Eloquent, and I just think that's bad advice. Once again, you got to pick the right tool for the job. And my impression is that in more cases than not, using something like Active Record with Eloquent is perfectly fine. We have this tendency in our community to say everything is dangerous. We talk about this a lot. Oh, if you do that, it's if you take that approach, it's dangerous. Well, really, like worst case scenario, once again, we're not all building Amazons. In most cases, we're building small to medium-sized projects. If you hit a trap, then you just fix it. You take some time to fix it. Nobody builds it perfectly the first time around. So I don't like that people always say everything is dangerous. It's not. It may not be ideal, but nothing is that dangerous short of taking credit card numbers and putting them in clear text into a database. That, I would say, is dangerous. Other than that, we're all figuring it out.
Yeah, and again, I mean, it depends on context. There are some things that could be dangerous if you are building an Amazon or an eBay. So it definitely depends on what you're using. And, you know, not to beat up on Doctrine too much, because I do like it now.
Oh, I think Doctrine has huge benefits. No, not at all. I'm not attacking Doctrine whatsoever. I want to favor simplicity over everything. That needs to be the focal point. And sometimes I feel like we have a tendency to miss that. We get so wrapped up into, like, the architecture styles and these patterns, and unless you're adhering to every single one of these patterns, then you're a bad developer, and that's dangerous. And it's like, no, the most important thing is that when you look at your code, it's simple. And then everything else comes after that. Those are great things to learn, as long as they make your code more simple. And if they don't, that's dangerous, I would say.
I think that a lot of people, myself included, can get like analysis paralysis, where you spend so much time trying to think about the architecture and all of this, you know, relationships and objects and stuff that you never actually write any code.
Yes.
You can always refactor bad code. You cannot refactor no code. So write some code.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I read a blog article about that like last week, basically saying that exact thing. If you fall into that architect astronaut trap, sometimes you end up in situations where you're analyzing so much more than you're producing, and that's very valid. I'm seeing somebody responded, and he said, Doctrine is simple. It doesn't make a small project more complicated. It has some advanced features, but you don't have to know about them. Okay. Then I would say to that group, speak out more and write more blog articles so that we know how easy it is. Because right now, that message is not being sent. People see the intro article, and it's like, whew, no thank you.
They did not mention me on that, so I did not get that.
Yeah, he missed
Let's see. Okay, so did you ever have an issue with a project because you couldn't think about a good front-end design? And if yes, how did you solve that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a designer. I think the best thing I could say about me is I'm not the worst designer. Like, I know plenty of engineers that are just ridiculous. It's almost like a badge of honor that, like, their design is just complete garbage. Like, there's not even a CSS file. It's just all text, you know, HTML. So I'm not that bad. But, yeah, like, it's hard when you have this great idea, or at least what you think is a great idea, and then it comes to the design and you just don't have the skills to go to that next level. It's hard, and sometimes like I've paid people to help me out. I think that's valid. I've spent a lot of time, not a lot of time, but like I don't want to be somebody who's a coder and then just completely knows nothing whatsoever about front end. So I focus a lot on front end, but I kind of hate it. Like front end, that world is like a black box. I've been using CSS for years and like I have no idea what's going on. I would much rather read the blue book than focus on some of the CSS stuff because it's weirdly confusing. It's like deceptively hard, I would say. When in term, like anyone can style a box, but when it comes to like how you, the architecture of your CSS and whether you create modules and how you name your classes and the advice changes every year on this stuff. So yeah, I prefer the back end, definitely.
Yeah, I'm not good at the front end, less and SAS and all of these things. I definitely look to people who are more skilled in that. I think my personal favorite right now is HTML5 up, I think is what it's
Faces,
called.
There you are. Okay, sorry, your face froze for a minute.
Oh, yeah, so HTML5 up is what I have been using, and they have some really, really, really well-designed free...
So these are like free templates or free themes that you can use? Yeah, that's nice.
So that's what I used for Do You Computer. And they're free and they're gorgeous, and I gave a big shout-out to the fellow who makes them.
They look great.
Yeah, I'm a big fan.
That's really nice.
Of that. Otherwise, it's usually just bootstrap and hope that it goes well.
Mm-hmm. Or another thing, that's the great thing about open source, is like if you have some good idea, then many times you'll end up with some designer who submits a PR to completely clean up the design of whatever it is you're building. That's happened to me a couple times. I've seen it countless times. So that's a nice perk if you make it open source.
Yes. I had a lot of good help on the Code Manifesto site because it was very minimal on the front end, and somebody came in and helped me with that. So. Yeah. Big help there.
Looks good.
Okay, so we are going to wrap up now. Anything you want to say for the good of the cause?
For the good of the cause? No. Self-promotion, laricast.com. I update it every day. Check it out. It's not too expensive. It's cheap. Check it out. I hope you like it.
Yeah, it's fun. I also suggest you do it. And also, I will be at Sunshine, as I mentioned, the latter half of this week, so come say hi, and I will have Hack the Stigma stickers on me.
Nice.
Like that one on my phone.
I like it.
So yeah, I will see you guys next time.
Cool. Thank you, Kayla.
Thank you, Jeff.